I just want to say this has been the most remarkable show, and probably the closest one to my own heart. When I was going to open this gallery, when I found out that this was a possibility, one of my first phone calls was to Mark, and I said, listen, I've got this opportunity to open a gallery in Socrates to take over Imogen Holloway. What do you think? He's like, do it. You know, you've done curating before. This shouldn't be hard for you. I said, yeah, but if I do it, will you show with me? And so now Mark has, after 1 year of me being open, he is finally satisfying his part of the bargain. And this is his show. And I want to thank you for encouraging me and also coming through on your part of the bargain. And here we are. So the thing that I have learned with living with this work now for about 2.5 weeks, we've got another week on the show, is to me this sort of the passion for classical art that we share. I love Mark's work because he's using the figure to kind of define space. And it's not just the figure, it's many figures, multiple figures, and it's even figures that aren't even defined. And I think that the kind of space that's created becomes a choreography. So I'm kind of been living with this and living with this sort of almost like dance, which I didn't expect when I was originally knowing Mark's work. I never considered his work as a kind of a choreographic dance experience. But after these past 2.5 weeks, that's what it is. And I find myself being quite a docent in that when people come in, I'm trotting out these books on Poussin and on Tiepolo, and a lot of the techniques, they are reminiscent of these classical art things that we love, but on the other hand, he's taking it into the 21st century because he's also integrating the New York Studio School, Hans Hoffman, and even things that we haven't even defined yet. And he's kind of plowing the way for the rest of us to understand this trajectory of art. All right, so I won't hog the limelight here, but I did want to just introduce Mark and also Mark Quasha. Oh, sorry, George Quasha. It's like I've got like two rock stars here because this is the third in our kind of artist series of what we call Crosstalk. And George, thank you for coming and engaging Mark in a discussion about his work and maybe about other things about art that are beyond, you know, just what's going on here. I'm going to introduce George first. Is that he's a poet, an artist, a writer, a musician, a general rock star who explores certain principles across many, 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 many mediums. And he's got a publishing house together with his partner, Susan. And they publish books as well as, and he does poetry. We've got 3 books of pre-verbs instead of proverbs. And books of writing on art and anthologies. And he performs axial music solo in collaboration with Charles Stein, David Arner, John Beaulieu, and Gary Hill. Oh my God. And he works in video. So this is a guy who's completely fluid in a lot of art media. So I would say this is a totally 21st century Renaissance man. And now here is our other Renaissance man, in both the fact that he's going back into the past and bringing into the future. Mark is a recipient of a Helena Rubinstein Foundation grant, and he participated in the NYFA Mark program. Mark again. And he's a well-respected painter and instructor. Currently, he's teaching at Columbia University, and this is one thing that Mark and I share, is we both lived in the town of Perugia. He lived as an instructor teaching at the school there, and I was there as a student. So happy I wasn't arrested for murder, like Amanda Knox. He's also taught
never
a purchase.
Found me out.
They never found you out, I guess. The monster of Florence. He'd also taught at Purchase, American University, Parsons, the list goes on. And he was also a curator, and one of the nicest shows I've ever seen in this area was at the Kleinert Museum, which was the New York School Generation in the Hudson Valley region. And that was a wonderful show that was a couple of years back, and hopefully he'll curate another show. Anyway, enough about these guys. Here we go.
On to these guys.
So, your name is Mark.
That's right.
Mine isn't.
I know.
However, since you name yourself Mark and you use that word a lot, I've noticed that in your artist statements.
Well, I say Mark.
You say, my work is derived from a process of mark making.
Right.
I don't think you mean autobiographical.
No, but I may, not consciously.
But, right. However, I think it's kind of an important point to start with, which is mark making. What do you mean by mark making?
So if we think about mark making, like making a mark literally on a piece of paper or a canvas, it's a very simple idea, right? You take a piece of charcoal or a brush loaded up with paint or whatever it is, ink, and you put something there that wasn't there before. But as a painter, there's conceptually, the way I see mark making is more of an inflection of the plane. If it's a piece of paper or a canvas or a panel, all of which are in the show, we're dealing with a four-sided plane that, when it's has no marks on it, has utter unity. And that plane, in one's imagination, could be either just an object, or it could be an infinite field. But it has utter unity either way. So the act of making a mark is an act that both breaks that unity, but the act of making many marks that have relationships to each other and to that field, that plane, can arrive back at unity. And that in and of itself is charged for me. It's charged with meaning for me. So, what we end up with is, hopefully something that has the same kind of unity that that was in the empty plane, but is filled with sort of the resonance of what of every making of mark. Uh-huh. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, good. This is great because, all right, we have this right here. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
This, that we have these what you call those drawings, right?
Sure.
Okay, and this is a painting.
Mm-hmm. Right?
So those are two different kinds of things.
Right.
So both of them start out with a blank.
Yes.
Okay. Is it different to make the first mark on that than to make the first mark on this? Is it the same? I mean, or is it similar? Is it related?
It's definitely related. It's not exactly the same. There's a difference between, for instance, these drawings, because they're ink, so there's an immediacy to mark making with ink because nothing disappears.
Right.
I mean, you can bring in another material and make it disappear, I don't think any of these have anything but ink. So there's an immediacy to it. So it's a very direct way of making a mark and then having to respond to that. And some of these are very simple. Some of them maybe have three elements, three actions that respond to each other. And some, well, for instance, Sherry, who's operating the camera, the one to the left of on that little partition wall,
yeah.
Well, that's four things, really. Okay. One, two, there's, and this one, for instance, is another, it's a very reduced, in its mark making, but the same thing that we were talking about applies. You know, the paintings, in a way, they're infinitely changeable because you can paint over, you can, you know, you can glaze over. There's all these technical things that occur. But the biggest distinction, in a way, between this work and this work, and I'll tell you, the thing that made this show, in a way, the idea that made the paintings in the show, was just a very simple quote from Philip Guston that I'd never heard before, which was that I heard I read a student of his recount, was he said, painting out is painting, right? So, you know, that's a very simple statement, but very profound.
Like painting over or painting?
Right, like if something's there and you go to put paint in to get rid of it, that's painting something out, but it's still painting.
Yeah, right.
So that intentionality is equal between trying to make something happen and trying to make something go away.
Right.
And those two things work together. So in a way, you know, that's intrinsic also, even though I couldn't paint out here, but I'm also, every mark isn't just about the mark, but it's about what it does to the field,
the whole field of operation.
Right, the plane.
Right. Okay, good. So that gesture is what we were talking about before called a first distinction. It's the first thing, whatever happens, if there's a first moment.
Right.
How do you go, what takes you from there to the next movement?
That's a good question. But I have to extend that idea a little bit.
Okay.
So we didn't talk about this when we were talking about that idea of the first
distinction.
But the first distinction is the fifth line, let's say. If the mark is a line, because we start with 1, 2, 3, 4, right? That's a very old painting idea, right? The first distinction is already relating to four other things.
You're regarding the edge of your medium as a line.
Well, it's an edge. It's not literally a line, but we can think of it. You know, if we completely abstract it, it's a rectangle. So that's made of four lines.
Four lines.
Right.
And so the next line would be an inner line.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Edge. Yes, but right. And it can describe something on one side of the edge and the other that relates to the four other edges.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, in a way, to get from that first distinction beyond is not that difficult because it's already relating. It's already relating
something
to, because the field is limited.
Right.
Unlike, you know, the world we live in, which is in some way conceptually limitless, if we think about cosmos.
You're not in touch with that, though.
No, you're not.
Your life is only in touch with limitations.
That's true.
You've got to step up on the curb.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true. That's why you can't make art without limitations, I don't think.
You'd have to be someplace other than on planet Earth.
I agree with that. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So, all right. So, what I'm getting at here is I'm building toward the question of what kind of action makes a painting. And what kind of feedback you get from that painting that continues it? What's the dialogue between you and that space? Since obviously you don't know what you're going to put on the space. In that respect, you're in the tradition of action painting.
Yes.
And that was a big... We were talking about this earlier. There was an extremely important essay that happened around 1952 by Harold Rosenberg, which he called action painting. And he created the word action painting in that. That's the context for this discussion. Which is that a lot of people actually have felt that there's a before that essay and an after that essay in art history. That essay defined a different approach to the surface of the canvas. That it was a field of action. It was an undeterminable possibility that connected to the energy and life of the person as a person. Who had given up all the other things that predetermined going to that space. Okay, so I see your work as somehow related to that tradition. Mm-hmm. It may have many other factors about it as well, but that's, that at least historically would be a kind of starting point.
Because it's pure process, it has, it's not responding to observing the world
and
literally
trying to do something with that. Right.
It's not fully concept. It's not only conceptual in that it's trying to be legible towards an idea.
Right.
The idea is that the action has resonant meaning for in its doing that then continues in the viewing, right? So that it's that the action, but I think that idea of unity is important because the action has to, has to build towards unity, and once that unity is achieved, then it can exist in the as an action in the viewer.
But the idea of unity,
response.
Do you know what unity is before you see it?
No. No, I don't know what it is before
so
I see it.
So unity is a singularity. It's something that happens in that moment. It doesn't relate to a concept of what. Because many of Hans Hoffmann's students of the abstract expression had very definite ideas, and the way he taught was very European, about there being some ideas of unity, because there are laws of color, laws of form, laws of line, and all that sort of thing.
Yeah, and I don't know that all of his students really painted that way, but there is a show of his up at the Met, and if you look at his work, it's I like his work, but it's like reading a really well written textbook.
I know.
You know,
right?
It's all there, and that's why I think some of his students actually went beyond what he was teaching.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
And in a way, you know, my teacher used to say, who was a Hoffman student, used to say that all the things he was teaching, mostly in drawing, he said this very confusing thing, which is this is just a pedagogy. He would say something, and you try to catch up to follow what he was saying, and then you feel like you had caught up to him, and he'd say, "But this is just a pedagogical device that you have to overcome."
Yeah.
I was like,
right.
"Oh, really? Thanks." Now where do I, what do I do? But I really understand what he means, because all that idea of unity, if it's coming out of that kind of didacticism, then it's just always about balance. It's not about it's not about like the way a crystal grows and then stops growing.
Okay,
it's more
so
like
let's try to say a little bit about what unity is, because what I'm getting at is what a person does when they're looking at a painting. Your painting.
Yeah.
And that, what is particular about that that's different from looking at a Renaissance painting? You make connections between Renaissance and these paintings, but actually they're completely different acts of human engagement.
Yeah.
And no matter what reference it might have to the past, that's not what's happening.
That's true.
Yeah.
But it's not what's happening, and it is what's happening.
Okay, tell me about
that. I think it's both. Well, it's not my saying. I've heard a number of people say this, and I don't know who said it first, but that artists have to be able to carry two opposing ideas simultaneously.
Okay.
So, in a way, I totally agree with you, and in a way, I also think it's completely connected to the same kind of experience.
So, what does the mind do when we're looking at a painting like this that would balance those ideas? Tell me if you can.
Well, I think I think what the mind does, what I'm interested in my work, it is not to make, and I'm going to use a word that generation that were working at the time of Rosenberg's essay would have used, that in a picture, they call them pictures, they didn't
call them pictures.
Yeah, they didn't know it. They both, but they call them pictures.
Terry Winter still calls them pictures.
Yeah, yeah. There's still, there's people around who are dear friend Paul Rezica, who's from that generation, calls them pictures. But they wouldn't think of a picture as where were we? We digressed on pictures.
Well, yeah. We, The question is, what kind of sense of unity?
Oh, yeah. Right. So, I'm not interested in having a picture be sort of like a visual text for which there is a reference that you have to then join towards psychologically. So, in other words, I don't want the painting or the picture to be legible. I want it to be an embodiment. So, you know, there's certain things that I think, or at least I've tried to, you know, assimilate over the years that make that have to do with geometry, that has to do with, I mean, I'm not thinking about these things. I think of them as the kind of things that musicians no longer think about when they're making music, but that are in there, you know, that are at one point conscious.
Or language,
right, exactly. Yeah. Like here we are talking in a language.
And we don't know what we're going to say.
And we don't know what we're going to say, and we don't have to think about, I'm going to put that sentence in the past tense, or is it going to be subjunctive?
You don't think about it.
Right, exactly. So language. It's good that I'm glad you mentioned language, because there's a certain way that visual language can become an embodiment and an evocation of an experience that is effective both psychologically but also somatically, so that your whole body understands where you are in relationship to this world, and that that gives openings to meaning that aren't available to just psychological references.
Right. You use the term visual language. That's an interesting term for me, because people sometimes use it in a way, it's almost like a code. Because we understand visuality, but we're speaking visually, something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think it goes beyond that. I think particularly your kind of work seems to be linguistic, lingual, functionally speaking, in dialogue with a possibility that's there. And that's kind of one of the things I'm wondering about, if you think of it that way. You're a very language-centered person. You're a literary person.
Yeah, you know. But you know who I think about all the time?
Who?
Is writers like Nabokov or Joseph Conrad. Because I'm thinking about writers who write in a language that's not their native tongue. It's like being a poet in a foreign language. And at some point you acquire the language and you no longer think in that language. When you learn a foreign language, at some point you begin to dream in that language, and it becomes natural. But if it's foreign to you, it's always foreign.
Okay.
And so you're also outside of the system. So you're not prone to the sort of quotidian ways of thinking through that language, because you're always outside of it.
Right.
So like somebody like Nabokov finds opportunities that native speakers in English never find. They find other things.
He finds new ones. But I'm interested in that because in some of these paintings, one sees what looks like figures.
Yeah, they are.
And that's what we agree to call configurative.
Yes.
Yeah. And how does that arise? I mean, in Nabokov, he seems to seek them out, opportunities that are in the landscape to bring out, landscape of a statement or a passage, to turn them into almost like a coded way of seeing that. I don't see you doing that. I see you finding things.
Yes.
And then working with what you find.
Yeah.
And maybe taking them a little further in the direction they seem already to be going. Is that right?
That is right. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It's about discovery.
Right.
It's not about imposing anything a priori.
Right.
It's always about discovery, but the paradox in some of these paintings, like the ones that you're pointing at, is that when things present themselves that are very figurative, my tendency is less to try to draw them out than to not eliminate them, but abstract them more. And that usually makes them come out stronger.
Uh-huh. So in other words, you don't say, oh, that looks like a horse, let's make it look really like a horse.
No, it's like, oh, this is looking like a horse. I better simplify it so it doesn't, because I don't want it to look like a horse. Yeah. If it's going to be a horse, then I'm fine. I'm happy to have a horse be there, right. But I don't want something that looks like one.
Right. So this is interesting because we talked about an old conversation we had years ago in which we said that I consider art to be have a third kind of art, not abstract or figurative, but configurative.
Yeah.
Right. Now, what I had in mind is that one has an option of seeing figures in the process of viewing.
Yeah.
So, in a painting like this, you wouldn't necessarily think figure, but it's figurational anyway. You might try to see a body right here or something like that, or this might look like a body, and it does kind of look like a body. But it would be figurational, and it wouldn't do you a lot of good to hang in there with that figure and then look for others and see if that is a key to the painting that I've now discovered all the figures that he... buried in this painting.
Yeah, it's not like looking for Nina's in a hearse. There's nothing like shoehorned in. So something that could be volumetric space, pictorial space, could at in another moment be a figure. And what seemed like a figure could be spatial.
Right.
That kind of it's not push and pull. I hate, by the way, I know we mentioned Hoffman, so I just want to lay that to rest right now. I think that's a completely misunderstood idea, he used a certain language, and nobody understands what he was saying.
Right.
And so I'd eliminate that language. But it's like, if you look at a Mondrian, right?
Yeah.
There's the grid, and then there's white, and there's colors.
Uh-huh.
And the one thing that I knew I had to understand Mondrian when I was a student. The key for me to Mondrian was a moment at which I saw that the grid was infinite and the white was up front, was all the way up front to plane, and then it reversed. And the white was infinite and the grid was up to plane. And it started doing this, and that created a rhythm, and then the chromatic relationships, it started becoming very musical in my experience. So. Right. So for me, you know, our experience of the world is implicitly all the time when our eyes are open, and our eyes are body, our eyes are part of our bodies. Our bodies are also moving and in relationship to other volumes and forms in space. Our experience of the world has a unity of form and space. So for me, that's important in the work, as abstract as it might be, that those two things are together. So then they can flip. One could be, and they do. I mean, if you know, people look at things over long periods of time, they tend to see different things. And I'll have people talk to me about what they see, and often they don't realize how much they're telling me about themselves by telling me what they see in the painting. Sometimes it's the same thing I see, but sometimes it's completely different.
So that's the configurative moment.
Right.
Exactly. And there's no right answer to seeing something. So unity, what you call unity, it's not a word I use a lot because it seems to make people think, or the mind think, that there's a thing called unity. Mm. But something like, I don't know, what would be a better word? Like coherence.
I use that word.
Yeah,
yes.
Something like coherence. So there's a moment at which, if I'm looking at this painting for a longish period of time, I've looked at some of your work for a longish period of time, this thing you were talking about what's the background, what's the foreground, figure ground kind of sense of it. Mm-hmm. Even when there's no figure in a painting that you would identify as a figure, but there's a configurative action going on, there is an event that's like figure ground and like the reversal of those, which becomes a kind of sense of depth.
Yeah.
Depth as though you're penetrating or moving into spaces and coming out of those spaces.
Right.
And this is a certain state of mind.
Yes.
That you end up with. So, what do you think about that?
Well, I think you're right.
Yeah.
But I would shy away from using the word figure ground because one of the things that's also true about how we experience the world is that, you know, we might see a figure, like our friend, and they might be far away from us, and there might be something behind them. But there's also something in front of them, and the thing behind them is the same thing that's in front of them.
Foreground, background. Right?
Well, it's space.
Space
is important, important to me, but not more important than form. But that's the coherence is those two things together. So, this happens in my work, but I'm willing to leave some doubt. But it's certainly what I'm interested in is that as things go to depth, the more they go to depth, the more they come forward. That has something to do with those rhythms, but also when something that moves to depth moves forward, you arrive at tension on that plane, that field of operation, and then the plane is no longer operating within its limits. It can expand relative to us, both psychologically and somatically, the way we relate to it. Where it doesn't have the literal boundaries. It's within that field, but that field isn't its size anymore. That's where scale comes
from. How about that you're able to see something you couldn't see in ordinary reality?
Yeah. Yes.
What do you think about that?
Yeah.
In other words, you have experiences in looking at a painting like this. If you live for a while in that, not we'll call it figure ground, but you're calling white space and grid or something like that those were inverting or in Mondrian. You know. But whatever that is that you're seeing that causes it to be dynamic and not a flat surface, but an event within a surface. What kind of possible state of mind or state of being do you want a person to be able to experience with that?
I don't want specific possibility. I want all. Actually, if I could, I would want all possibility.
Okay.
Because in a way, I'm interested in works of art that elicit things from me as a viewer that I didn't know existed. They're not necessarily in the work itself.
Right.
But the work. It creates a dynamic that draws stuff out. It's just like when somebody says something that you've never articulated, you've never really thought through, but you know instantly that you've known it your entire life.
Right. So it's a recognition, but of something you don't have a name for, don't know what it is, but it feels real. It has a reality. And you're recognizing that it's got a reality.
It has a reality, but it's not. It's not necessarily anything that you could pin down with verbal language, unless it was poetic language.
Right. Now, Rosenberg talked about that event in painting as though it were like a conversion experience. That one, if one was looking at things formally and had the idea that they could understand the formal dynamic or the laws of that or really just understand it in ordinary terms, like geometry.
Sure.
There we're talking about Euclidean geometry, something real basic. But he talks about how that one's converted to another kind of mind.
Yeah.
A kind of open action mind.
Yes.
What is that we're talking about? Because you're drawn by attraction.
Yes.
These are not arbitrary forms. It isn't the idea that you've created something that's never been seen before and yippee, I make something that guy didn't have over there.
Right.
But it's something you're drawn to. You're living it with your body mind as though it really meant something. It really matters to you.
Right.
And in a sense, you're kind of in love with that experience. I guess.
Right.
So how do you feel about that?
Well, I feel like that it has that possibility has resonance the way a dream might, because it's a possibility that doesn't exist in the world. And that connects to that Rosenberg idea, and it also connects to the idea of what the name of the show is, right? Because that conversion experience that Rosenberg talks about, he also describes it as being a conversion to a private myth.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Yeah, that's exactly what he said.
Yeah, and so you know,
So I'm thinking about creation myth.
Right. So thinking about myth is not just like a story that's nice to hear and maybe describes how something we don't understand happened in the past, which is the way the idea of myth is often
that's mythology. Relayed. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. But myth is sort of the way you know a whole society deals with what is beyond what can be spoken about.
Okay.
Right? So the privateness of the myth is in the process for me as the artist, in the action and the inflection of that field and trying to bring it to a coherence that it has without me back to something that it has with me. Mm. So with that whole process and all that experience charging it, but then it's you know what I'm hoping that the viewer also it elicits from the viewer. So I think that for me that's sort of what you're talking about, that you would care, that you said you know you look at it and you care about without knowing specifically why.
Yeah, and you're attracted to it. You're drawn to it.
You're right, and I hope that's true. First of all, I'm not going to say that.
They wouldn't keep looking at it if they weren't, right?
Right, yeah, right. Yeah. And so it's. So hopefully the paintings are introducing you to to not yourself, but part of the relativity of self that you're not always
or the dimensionality seeing. That there are other dimensions of being present with what you see in the world.
Right, that's a good way of putting it. Yeah. That there is a dimensionality that we reduce.
Now, Rosenberg has a tendency to reduce that to the psychological or the referential or something like that. There's a kind of polarity there. He says it's a secular conversion.
Right.
Right. Do you agree with that? Is it purely secular, or does it have a spiritual dimension, or does it have a soul dimension? Does it have a something that isn't definable by psychological, which we tend to think of in terms of something that you can name and get in touch with and then liberate so that your life is better or something like that?
Right. Well, that essay was written at a time when Freudian ideas and Jungian ideas were very, very strong. Right. And I would say, like, the Jungian notion of archetypes would be more like what we were talking about than like a purely, like, more like Freudian psychological way of looking at it. But I'm not adverse to spiritual, and I think it's been a dirty word in art criticism for a long time. But a couple of really powerhouse art historians, critics who I know who I've talked to, are you know working on spirituality and art right now, and I think that we're due for a reassessment of that, but I don't know how to really describe what that is, because I'm not working on that through writing. If I'm working on it, I'm working on it through this activity that we're trying to pin down with language, which ultimately is
which is another contribution that I think Rosenberg's essay makes, which is to identify the action that the painter is committing to a kind of thinking. That this is an alternative and completely different modality of human thinking. That what we're doing with our mind is doing something really different. And thinking isn't anti-spiritual either. I mean, it isn't anti-anything. It's just a process that we can't define.
Right. Yeah. But if there's a kind of thinking that does not include any thinking, then yes.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. No thinking about what you're doing necessarily. Right. Although, here's another question. You still hold in mind a kind of conceptual field, or I call it the principle field, in which there's a certain basic understanding that allows you to go from canvas to canvas to canvas, work to work to work, and have them be extremely different in how they might appear when next to each other. But there's something in them that is, I hate the notion of signature, because that's been turned into a commercial thing, or signature, but something like the imprint of your particular being, something that belongs to you. I mean, even in John Cage's work, which is very, which is supposedly chance operational, you can tell a Cage drawing normally. You know, I mean, they've got a certain quality that has got the stamp of it. How that gets there is a very interesting question.
Yeah. I think you're absolutely right. I totally agree with that. And I don't know how anybody can really eliminate that.
Yeah.
Although people have, but I think a lot of work where people worked really hard to eliminate that, then they eliminate a lot of babies with bathwater.
I don't know what they're afraid of. They think, I mean,
and you know, there's a physical aspect to making these things too.
Well, let's talk
about that. The body is doing something, and the mind is doing something, and they're working together.
Right.
And well, for me, in the process, I mean, I don't want to get into like specific detail about how these are made. Technically, but. Mm-hmm. You know, I will sit and look, you know, and do nothing.
Uh-huh.
So I don't even know. I can only guess at how. I know it's a long time sometimes, and then I know that's what needs to be done, and I'm not always right, but I usually am. You know, and sometimes I'm wrong because sometimes I'm thinking it through, but usually I know I act, and then that sets off a whole nother response. So,
right.
So that first, what was that mathematical principle that we were talking about?
Well, first distinction.
The first distinction, there's an echo of that throughout the process, because there are moments when there is a sort of a coherence that is inchoate, but it requires some kind of reflection, and then there is an understanding of what seeing of what needs to happen, and then that act is another, echo of that first.
Right. The metaphor of music, which you brought up before, is interesting here, because certain sounds allow other sounds to happen after them. You can either use a model, like you've got a tune in your mind when you do that, which is how a lot of jazz improvisation occurs, or not.
Right.
You can simply let the sound itself dictate the next sound.
Right.
And there's no way of knowing how that's going to work until it actually happens, because it's, so I think I feel like that first gesture you make, that it creates an allowable field of a next gesture. You can't arbitrarily make any gesture from that moment on. It has created somehow a kind of necessity that you don't know how, you're not in command of, but which you have to serve in some way.
And within that, just like in music, there are also rests. There are places where the act, or like we were saying before, mark making has to create something that is other than the mark, has to also create the non mark. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You know, and just like
silence,
the note and the rest, the intervals between notes, allow the notes to be something.
Right. Yeah.
And you know, that gets back to our idea of form and space. There, the space on the flat plane can be thought of as the same ideas of musical intervals. It's like an interval, right? And it's not. You know, it's not an illusion in my work. At least that's what I'm trying desperately not to have it.
But you're talking about the physicality of this process, and Jen was talking about how she's probably, when no one's in here, she's dancing around the room, just to, but there's some kind of physical process that you go through that's embedded in this in some way, and that she's reading out when she has the idea that she felt these are danceable.
Yeah,
it almost as though they're like scores for an action of mind that includes an image of dancing or quality of dancing.
Well, I'll say that there has been a conscious thought for me as an artist for, decades now. There are certain artists you feel like there's movement on something that is literally still.
Mm-hmm.
And those, you know, there are artists like, Pollock, within the realm of of the Rosenberg era. But, you know, Rubens is a great example of that. Or Delacroix. But Rubens more than Delacroix was working from, working off of Rubens' notebooks and really trying to go after Rubens.
Right.
I think we can see Delacroix better than we can see Rubens. Because Rubens is more remote, but I think the older I get, the more I see what a master he was, and even though there's that, like that different kind of pre-action intentionality, there is that capture of
an actual paradox of motion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. And so I've always been interested in that, but it is physical. I don't know how it happens. It's a conscious thing, but it doesn't. But you know, the physical thing is also, for me, the way I approach these things physically is also informed by, you know, how do you physically disengage the eye-hand connection where the hand is a projection of your thinking mind,
mm-hmm.
and how do you put a movement or action out of the body into a painting, you know, without having, you know, that conscious, uh-huh. like, I'm going to do this, you know, with my hand.
Right.
And so,
Where does it come from in the body?
Well, it comes from the center. It
comes from the center.
Yeah.
That's really different from how those painters paint.
Yeah, maybe.
I'm going to have to step in here, only because... It is zombie night tonight. But I did want to also leave a little room for a little question from the audience, if you guys don't mind. Do we have a moment? Can we ask, open up the...
It was just getting interesting.
So,
I know, it is interesting.
Can I just very quickly wrap up that idea of moving from the center? And I know George understands, because I've learned, through
Aikido
and then Tai Chi, and then, you know, the connection... we have through Tai Chi is that we move with conscious and unconscious intention, but we don't move freely unless we are moving from our center. So I'm trying to I've gotten that into the mark making
in both senses.
Yeah.
All
right.
Nice.
Well done.
We could talk about this very subject for the entire hour.
So let's have another hour.
Oh,
no.
Okay.
So, questions?
Anybody have any questions for Mark?
I don't really have a question, but I want to get back a moment to that viewing and finding figures.
Uh-huh.
Because what I've found, and other people have said, not just me, is that process, and that's about the viewer, that process is the same as looking for a mistake. That's what happens. So people who I call chronic non-viewers of paintings, that's all that they can see. They look at something and they're looking for the it, and the it that they're looking for is this figure, whether it's a body or it looks like a dragon and a cloud. They have to give it some sort of form in that way. And that physical process is indeed the same as looking for a mistake.
Maybe so. But his paintings teach you how to let that go.
Because
you can't take it very far, and yet you don't give
up. Well,
you
can easily see figures. I mean,
yeah, that's what I mean.
But
you can't keep seeing figures.
Well, surely you can.
Well, I mean, it wouldn't be very... much highly figured.
It's like the impulse to name as opposed to just like let it be. Like that.
It's more like the vase in the face.
Well, I think what George said was interesting, and I agree with what I think he said, which is that you can see figures, but ultimately you're seeing an entire evocation of experience.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes beyond any specific imagery. So if you, like, I don't really feel like some of these are more specific than others. I know that is true, but I feel like there's really nothing specific in any of them because they're all configurative, using George's term. So at like when you're engaged over, and I know it's not the way we deal with imagery in the world now, and we have feature-length movies in our pocket. But if you engage over time, then that become those discoveries then add up to more than the sum of their parts. I hope.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they you kind of go beyond just, you know, naming.
And like, they keep moving.
Locking them down.
They keep moving.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. Yes, Heather.
You can't talk.
But I think the figure is definitely, informed by you. I see that. But what isn't informed or controlled or is there's, you're not giving it a narrative. And I think that's like what you leave open. But I think the figure, you're pushing the figure.
some of the figures are informed by you.
Save that for the
Or the figures are pushing him.
Yeah, I mean, look,
in a way, as George was saying, the issue is it going to be more rewarding or more disappointing, the search for figurative relations in the painting? Do you feel that the more you find, the better an experience you have? To me, I know almost immediately that I'm going to be disappointed if I go on a treasure hunt.
But I think it's both at the same time. It's you're rewarded when you see one, and you're rewarded when you let it go.
Right.
And then that becomes a rhythm of the experience, within the experience, that you know, then sets up a longer term relationship with what you're seeing.
Right.
They're definitely, whatever else they are, they're not things that can be taken in all at once, you know. And so, but they can too. I mean, I think that they're existing constantly in many different paradoxes.
But figuration is also rhythmic.
Yeah.
So if you get actually what's happening in his paintings, you're not fixing on a figure. You're not drawn to fix on a figure. You're getting with a kind of event that this figure is part of. It's got a rhythmic identity that you're just discovering in the process of seeing. And I think that's what happens to me when I'm looking at
this. Yes. And you're involved. You're involved with it. If you give it a little bit of attention, you're
right. And that moment doesn't have a you and an it.
Right.
It's some kind of a
marriage. And in that way, it doesn't have a painter and a viewer either.
That's what I mean.
That's where, you know, we meet too,
exactly.
Within that.
But I think you enter that state when you're doing the listening of long silences and waiting and then knowing what gesture you have to make. And that stays in the work if the work has the integrity of that gesture. If you keep the integrity of that gesture, it feeds back into a viewing. That's
a good, very well said. I hope that's true. Alan?
I've got just kind of a follow-up question about the piece behind you, having observed it for an hour while buzzing, bantering back and forth makes you see things that you wouldn't ordinarily pay attention to. But let's not call them figures, let's call them forms, whatever. But I can't help but observe that what appears to be the head on the forms in most cases is dark. Might that have any significance or meaning for you, or is it just more of a graphic?
Doesn't have a significance for me that I could talk about. I mean, it all has significance for me, but it's not something specific. Like, I don't think, I don't know. I mean, what significance does it have for you?
It could have significance if I wanted to let my mind say it does, but I'm avoiding that.
Yeah. And it could have a lot of different significance,
right,
I guess, is why I turned it back around.
Yeah, sure.
That's the point, put you on the spot.
I guess my reaction is similar to yours. So,
well, what you're discovering when you let that go is that you have choice in the alternative states of reading what you're looking at. So you use legibility, but I've used it in the sense of having legible as something. Mm-hmm. So I read it as something. But there are kinds of reading, which we, as a poet, I know very well, that have indeterminacy in them. Mm-hmm. Degrees of assigning value or meaning to what it is that you're reading. And that when you get into a certain flow with that, you're actually in a kind of territory of the imagination of that artist. You're being inwardly guided by that work in ways that you can't account for. That's that's a discovery of an alternative state of reading.
And the indeterminacy, which is a very Cajun type word,
yeah,
is also indeterminate significance. Like, there's no significance, and there's all sorts of possible significance.
And all degrees in between.
Yeah.
It's a continuum. Meaning is a continuum.
Right. So then it's an event of potential?
Yeah, engage in, so then whatever, yeah, so anything, yeah, it's yeah, let's just say yes. I can't say, yeah, I think so.
My question kind of relates to this. In the creative process, are these figures evolving from the mark? Did the mark come first and maybe suggest the form, and the figures grew out of that? Or do they work
both
ways?
Yes, because the mark. Well, yes, yes, and no, because the mark comes first. Yes, and the marks create relationships to each other and out to the edges of the plane that sort of are, you know, hopefully always going towards cohesion. And then, yes, then there's a suggestion of a form, and then that can be, but it's not always, see, there's certain things that we might agree upon that we see as figurative, or configurative is the word we've been using. But there are other ones that we won't agree on that people will absolutely have to insist upon.
Insist upon.
Right? And I'm sometimes very surprised by those for lack of a better word, readings. Mm-hmm. You know, especially when they're so determinate. Because I do think they're indeterminate. But that tells you a lot about who's looking at it. I mean, I'll tell you an anecdote about one of these, about one, a big painting was in a gallery, in a group show. I walked into the gallery, and I hadn't seen it, without people mulling around at the opening, and I was just, like, kind of looking at my own painting. And the woman came up to me and said, and she obviously was somebody who wasn't really going to be good at selling them any work. I was really kind of surprised by this in a way, but she asked me if I liked the painting, and I said, yeah, I like this painting, because I wanted to see where she was going, right? And she said, I don't like it. I said, why? Like, this is obviously somebody who was just there to, like, was just paid to sit in the gallery because they didn't have anybody else. And she said, because all I see are cigarettes, ashtrays, and skulls. I was like, okay, now I have a whole...
You didn't ask her out.
That sounds like a great painting.
Cigarettes, I kind of felt that way. I was like, I thought the same thing, and I know, I thought, well, that does sound like a great painting, but I now know you so much better than you think I do.
Yes.
Now that you told me that, and it has nothing to do with anything that I could ever have. And I do see things in the, it's not that I don't see these things. But it's both things at once. Like I was saying before, it's they're holding contradictory ideas equally, I think, is important for art. And these, and I gave up long ago. I mean, I remember years ago, a critic actually told me that I had to choose whether it was going to be, I was going to be an abstract artist or a figurative artist. And I struggled with that for probably years, trying to, like, work through just, like, one thing that person said once.
I know, it's bummer.
And then I saw them again. They didn't think that at all. They looked at my work again. They had something completely else to say. It was just what they were thinking at the moment. But I was young, and it affected me for a really long time. You know, and then finally I realized it doesn't matter. It's both at once and neither.
Yeah.
Thank you. I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. And I, the show's up for another week, so come back when there isn't so many of us here and enjoy it as I've been enjoying it. And don't get caught up in the zombie traffic.
And thank you, Jen, for mounting the show.
Well, thank you, man. I wouldn't have opened this gallery if it wasn't for you saying, right, I'll show with you.
Well, that's very sweet. And thank you for coming.
Thank you.